Hey, good morning, Wildwood. Glad you've chosen to join us this morning. The days are getting warmer and spring's definitely here. Trees are budded out and it's a great time of the year. It's a great time to be together. I wanted to open this morning just Psalm 150. It's not a very long psalm, but it's full of energy. Praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty heavens. Praise him for his mighty deeds. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Praise him with trumpet sound. Praise him with lute and harp. Praise him with tambourine and dance. Praise him with strings and pipe. Praise him with sounding cymbals. Praise him with loud clashing cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So if one of you wants to come up here and sit in the drum set and do the cymbal thing, you know, we can probably work that up. So, you know, everything we have to praise the Lord, and I guess crashing, loud clashing cymbals could do that too. Anyhow, we're glad that you're here, and I'd invite you to stand as we pray. Lord, we just want to praise you with all that we have, all that you've given us, all that you've blessed us with our bodies and our whole hearts and our minds and our souls and our hands. Lord, just hear our praise today because you are the great God, the great creator of all things, that your love endures forever, and we praise you. Amen. We'll sing a little bit here.
Take the name of Jesus with you, child of sorrow and of woe. It will joy and comfort give you. Take it then wherever you go. Precious name, oh how sweet, hope of earth and joy of heaven. Precious name, oh how sweet, hope of earth and joy of heaven. Oh, the precious name of Jesus, how it thrills our souls with joy. When his loving arms receive us, and his songs our tongues employ.
Precious name,
precious name,
oh
how sweet, hope of earth and joy of heaven.
Precious name,
precious name,
oh
how sweet, hope of earth and joy. Jesus bowing, falling prostrate at his feet. King of kings and heads will crown him when our journey is complete.
Precious name,
precious name,
oh
how sweet, hope of earth and joy of heaven. Precious name,
precious name,
oh how sweet, hope of earth and joy of heaven. Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed through his infinite mercy. His child and forever I am. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the redeemed, redeemed, his child and forever I am. I think of my blessed Redeemer, I think of him all the day long. I sing for I cannot be silent, his love is the theme of my song. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, his child and forever I am. I know I shall see in his beauty the King in whose law I delight, who lovingly guardeth my footsteps and giveth me songs in the night.
Redeemed
by the blood of the Lamb.
Redeemed.
His child and forever I am.
Amen. You may be seated. This is just another part. I read out of the Psalms nearly every day. And I think it's just a great way to start to think about, different ways that people praise. And there's some Psalms that really talk about, that really get after God. Oh God, why have you deserted me in my time of need and my trouble? And I don't know if you've ever talked to God like that. But if you have, he can take it. I can tell you that. But let's read this part of this together as we go. Here we go. Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. His greatness no one can fathom. One generation commends your works to another. They tell of your mighty acts. They speak of the glorious splendor of your majesty. Amen.
Marvelous grace of our loving Lord, grace that exceeds our sin and our guilt. Yonder on Calvary's mount outpoured, there where the blood of the Lamb was spilled. Whiter than snow you may be today. God's grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. God's grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin. Marvelous, infinite, matchless grace, freely bestowed on all who believe. You that are longing to see his face, will you this moment his grace receive? Grace, grace, God's grace.
I may have mentioned in the past, we've had a plethora of baptisms recently, and not all of them we've been able to get on video, but we have several, and we wanted to take some time to show you that today, just so you can experience what some of these people went through, and also to tell you that we have several more that are already planned. And so I don't know what God is doing here. I mean, it's obviously amazing and wonderful and splendid, but anything we did, it's God working through all of us. So let's share this video.
Do you believe Jesus is the Christ?
Yes.
And I'm privileged to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Thank you. Ivan, do you believe in Jesus Christ?
Yes.
So I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Baptized by his Sunday school teacher. Then we saw Yvonne being baptized by his mother. This is Grant, and his parents are standing up here. Good job. Thank you for raising a son like this who knows the truth. Step forward, turn around. Grant, in the power of Christ, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. What an appropriate name you have, Christian. Thank you to your family, to your mother, and to those who have spoken the Christ into your life, who have given you the hope in Him. So it's my privilege now to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
I've seen you repeat after me. I believe that Jesus is the Christ.
I believe that Jesus is the Christ.
The Son of the living God.
Son of the living God.
I accept him as my Lord and Savior.
And I accept him as my Lord and Savior.
Yes. I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Alright, hey Thomas. Do you believe that Jesus was the Son of God?
Yeah.
Do you believe that He died and rose again for the forgiveness of your sins? And do you want to commit to follow Him for the rest of your life? Alright, on that confession of faith, I will now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
This is Brianna Herrick. I've had the privilege of knowing her entire life, and I'm honored that she's asked me to be here this morning while she gets baptized. So, Brianna, do you believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God?
Yes.
Okay. Upon the confession of faith, your mom is going to baptize you. Be buried with Christ, raised to walk in life. A special girl in my life, and I was honored that she asked me to baptize her. So, Samantha,
yes.
Okay, all that confession of faith, I'll baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
So we've had all those kids and adults and all different stories, but all ending the same way, starting a new life of Christ. So would you repeat after me? I believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. Amen.
Far dearer than all that the world can impart was the message that came to my heart. How that Jesus alone for my sin did atone, and Calvary covers it all. Calvary covers it all. Mine past with its sin and stain, my guilt and despair, Jesus took on him there, and Calvary covers it all. How matchless a grace when I looked on his face of this Jesus, my crucified Lord. My redemption complete, I've been found at his feet, and Calvary covers it all. Calvary covers it all. My past with its sin and stain, my guilt and despair, Jesus took on him there, and Calvary covers it all. How blessed the thought that my soul by him bought shall be his in the glory on high, where with gladness and song I'll be one of the throng. And Calvary covers it all. Calvary covers it all. My past with its sin and stain, my guilt and despair, Jesus took on him there. And Calvary covers it.
During the days of Jesus' life on earth, he offered up prayers and petitions with fervent cries and tears to the one who could save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverent submission. Son though he was, he learned disobedience from what he suffered. And once made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who believe. This is a different and in my experience, an unusual portrayal of the salvation we have in Christ. Yes, we know that he offered up those prayers and petitions in the garden. He offered up his fervent cries and tears. But we don't think about him submitting, reverent submission. We don't think about him learning obedience from what he suffered. Didn't he know all things? Well, intellectually he knew them. But he didn't know them experientially until he went through them. And so he went through this suffering. And in doing so, he made perfect. And he was made perfect, and became the source of salvation for all who obey him. Have we been living a life of reverent submission? Have we been willing to learn obedience by going through suffering? Sometimes I think I have. Recently I've been reading the biography of a Christian man who lived for Christ in China, and I look at what he went through and I go, wow, I don't have a close an idea what it means to be obedient, to go through what he went through. You know, suffering wouldn't be so bad if it just didn't hurt so much. And how obedient can we be? And in him, we are made perfect in him, because we find our salvation in him when we submit to him in humble obedience. As we partake of this, the broken body, the cup, his shed blood, remember how he submitted and how he calls us to obedient submission, that we can live in the salvation that he so freely offers to us. God bless us now as we partake of the loaf and the cup, that we do so in remembrance of what Christ did for us, and that we determine, dear Lord, to bow to him in humble obedience wherever it would take us, whatever it would demand of us, May we be obedient like him, be obedient through him, be obedient because of him, and learn through the suffering that you have us endure for him. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
As we come to our offering time, it's important for us to remember the mission of the church. While the Christian church exists, that we can make disciples through evangelism and nurture. God has put us here to share the message of the gospel with ourselves and anyone else that we can reach. And it's when we come to our offering time that we oftentimes talk about how we need to pay the bills and the staff and take care of all our obligations with our missionaries and so forth. But being a Bible-believing church, I looked at a verse in 2 Corinthians again and realized that maybe our offering time has gotten a little bit, well, rushed in this modern life. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 7 says this, "Each of you should give as you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver." Now, the reason I say that our offering time maybe is a bit rushed is we don't give you much time to consider or to decide what it is that you want to give. Too often, we give to God in the same way that we tip a waiter or waitress. Maybe we round it up. Maybe we just see what's in our pocket. Here's a five, here's a ten, here's a $2 bill. They still exist. I saw one the other day. But have you really taken the time and said, "Lord, what do you want me to give?" God doesn't need our money. He has plenty. God doesn't worry about the stock market declining or the housing bubble crashing. But he does care about our hearts and our giving and our participation in the gospel. So I just want to give you a moment or two right now just to prayerfully ask, "Lord, what is it that you want me to give today?" And I'll let you decide. There are boxes in the back, an app on your phone. You can send a check or drop it off. But I just want you to take a moment and just consider between you and God what it is that he wants you to give. Just let's take that moment. Lord, you have blessed us beyond belief. You have given us more than we can even imagine. And we want to be sober and serious about how we live our lives, how we spend every moment, how we expel every breath, and how we spend every dollar. Make us good stewards, Lord. Let us consider what you're doing in and through us. For I thank you for this generous church. But Lord, let us be in your will and your ways. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, today is graduation Sunday. Did you get that from the banner outside and everything that's going on? Yeah. Graduation Sunday is always an amazing time for me because it reminds me that life moves fast, doesn't it? It just seems like May comes around so very quickly. I was reminded of that just this past week. A week ago, Saturday, everything was fine in my world. Sunday morning, last week, I got up and got in my car and started up and tried to drive to church. It got about, I don't know, 4 or 5 blocks from home, and it just quit. It just died. Yeah, I had to call my wife, and she had to come and rescue me. So on Monday, we put about $1,700 into the car. On Tuesday, $400 more went to repairing the car. On Tuesday afternoon, I was really pleased it was all fixed. And then I had a car accident. Yeah, we're waiting to see whether or not they're going to repair it or it's going to be totaled. All in the course of about 3 days, I went from fine to not so good to now I'm wondering what's going on. But you know, that's just the way life goes sometimes. It goes by fast. Graduation Sunday always reminds me of this. It's a day for us to give praise to God for the young people that have grown up in this church. And we want to give honor to God by honoring those who have reached a milestone in their educational journey. I myself have walked across the stage and graduated 4 times. Yeah, that's a lot of work. But you have graduated from things. So here's what I want to do. If you've graduated from my school at any point in your life, I just want to hear what year that was. We're going to say it all at once. Ready? So 3, 2, 1, you just tell me what year you graduated. 3, 2, 1. Did somebody say 1800 something? Who said that? You know, the year that we graduated was a big deal when I was growing up, right? Our class was better than any other class, right? 1983, boy, does that sound old. 83 was better than anybody else. That's when I graduated high school. Now, I remember when my son graduated preschool. Who's ever heard of such a thing? 4 years old, he gets done with preschool, and there he stands in his little robe and his cap, his tassel, and he's holding his diploma. Maybe he was so cute, right? Since then, he's graduated high school and college and graduate school. And so it's just amazing how quickly all that goes by. Now, the cap and the gown and so forth, we have Oxford University, amongst others, to give credit to for all of that regalia, all of that tradition that we have. Right? What does it really mean? Well, the gown is sort of like a lab coat to a medical doctor. It's supposed to denote that you have been taught to the place where you get to be the teacher, and that's your sign, that's your uniform to be a professor. As a matter of fact, there are still colleges, especially in England, where the professors wear all of that every day that they teach. Yeah, show-offs, right? The cap is supposed to be like a mortar board, like for a bricklayer. You know, it's time to go to work, and you've been given the tools of your trade. That's why it's square and flat, and you wear it on your head. I guess you're really a good bricklayer if you can carry the mud on your head like that. I don't know how that came about. The tassel, different colors mean different things, but moving it from the right to the left is saying now something is different, something is new, and then, of course, the diploma itself is simply the credentials that you could show to somebody. It's why doctors and lawyers and so forth hang it on the wall to prove that they are educated. Well, Jesus' life when he was a child went by so fast as well. As you know, in the New Testament, we don't have very much history of Jesus between his birth narrative and his adult ministry. As a matter of fact, it's simply summed up by saying this, that Jesus grew in wisdom and stature and favor with God and all people. In other words, Jesus grew up. I look back and I say, what happened to all the years? I've been here long enough now, and this is why I like long pastorates, is I've been here long enough that the kids that are graduating this year were literally babies or being born when I first got here. That makes me feel so... No. Makes me feel so proud of them. What are you talking about old? You went right to that, didn't you? But the truth is that when we want to celebrate graduates here, it's because it's not just one or two or those that we are most connected with, but these are our kids from our community. Do you get that sense? Maybe you don't know all their names. Maybe you don't know all their stories. Maybe there's some you don't know at all, but it's still, these are kids that grew up in and through and with us. And we're proud whether they're graduating from high school or college, or beyond. It's just amazing to be able to see what God is doing in and through their lives. It's a time for laughter and for tears. It's a time for potential to be realized and excitement for where their God is taking them. That's why it's interesting that we've always had these milestones. That's where we get the idea of graduation, by the way. There are marks that we're graduating, these milestones, these moments. Your measuring cup at home, by the way, is graduated. Did you know that? If you look on there and it says quarter cup, that's a graduation. It says half cup, that's a graduation. It's simply marking the time as we go through. And graduations do that. You've graduated from preschool. You've graduated from elementary school. You've graduated from middle school and high school and so forth. Well, Paul did the same with his student or his protege, Timothy. It's interesting that he says this. Listen, he says, there will be terrible times. People will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boastful, proud, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, without love, unforgiving, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not lovers of God or the good, but treacherous, rash, conceited, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying its power. Paul, this is a really depressing graduation speech, right? Because Paul says to his student, his protege, Timothy, we live in a world that is in a mess. You and I can still say that today. As a matter of fact, I think that I bring this up is because as we look at the world around us today, and we want to look forward with such optimism, with such faith, with such excitement, and we see all that's going on, what we really need to rely on is our education, you know, the things that God has taught us to know even how to live in a world like this. Did you hear what he says? People will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money and so forth. I watch the news and I see this happening over and over again. It's like, how do we as believers in Jesus, how do we as Christians think about this whole idea with the Roe v. Wade decision, the abortion law, the Supreme Court and so forth? And I see people out there saying, it's my body, it's my choice. Well, you know what I've been taught? That all of my life is about God's choices. I will listen to anyone who tells me, this is what God says, this is what God is teaching, this is what Scripture highlights. We want to do what God wants, not what I want. My best thinking has gotten me into a whole heap of trouble time and time again. And if I've learned anything through all of my education and all of my experience, and you have too, you have learned that we are to seek first the kingdom of God. And then all these things will be added to us. Now, I want to say this because we need to understand and know our times. We need to understand what's happening around us and how we fit into it, because I believe that we have been born for this time. It was not a coincidence that you were created now. It's not a coincidence that you graduated in whatever year you shouted out a moment ago, right? 1943 or 67 or 89 or whatever it was. God created you to live in this time frame and has taught you that you have a place, a position, and that you have been graduated, you have been marked along the way, and you have an impact to have upon this society and this time. So, back to Paul's speech to Timothy at his graduation, if you will. I'm in 2 Timothy chapter 3. He says this, 2 Timothy 3, 14 through 17. He says, but as for you, Timothy, right, speaking to him very specifically, he says, continue in what you have learned and have firmly believed. What you have learned in the past, hold on to that, he says, and live by those standards. And then he lists them out, knowing from whom you learned it and how from childhood you have been acquainted with the sacred writings, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. Then he adds in, all Scripture is God-breathed and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. Let me summarize what he's saying. Paul says to Timothy this, and I think to the rest of us as well. He says, but as for you, as you see the way that the world is just blowing itself apart, chasing after all kinds of false philosophies and ideologies, he says, you remember what you have been taught since the youngest days. And who taught it to you? I could list, and you could too, some of the Sunday school teachers, college professors, just common people who invested in my life, teaching me all kinds of things. And sometimes I learned it with wonder, and other times I was a bit more resistive. But they taught me from the word itself, because that's where, in the sacred writings, we find the truth. Because Scripture itself doesn't come from any human person, but rather comes from the very breath of God himself. This is where we have sometimes forgotten the purpose of education. The purpose of education is to help me discover who I am, why I'm born now, and what God wants me to do. Every generation has their form of finding their own identity. I need to go find myself, someone may say. In this modern times, people don't know who they're gender is or who they are as a person, and they're searching for that, and I honor that, while at the same time I say that I want to agree with Eugene Peterson, who said this: our lives are not puzzles to be figured out. Rather, we come to God, who knows us and reveals the truth in us in our lives. The fundamental mistake is to begin with ourselves and not God. God is the center of all that develops. Okay, what is he saying there? If we want to know how to solve the problems in our times, we can't look to any other theology or philosophy but God himself. Amen? If we want to know who we are as people, we have to stop looking at who we are and rather see who God created us to be. Again, these graduations, these ideas that at moments I have clarity, these milestones that we go through. Now, it's not just when we get to wear a cap and a gown, but it can be every day when I wake up in the morning and say, Lord, what are you and I going to do today? Because God, you are at the center of my life every single day for what I give, what I eat, where I go, what I say, what I don't say, and what do I accomplish and what I let go. In the Apostles' Creed, which some churches recite, but that's just not part of our tradition. We don't do that. It begins simply by saying this: I believe in God the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth. Can you repeat that with me? Let me say it again. I believe in God the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth. Say it with me. I believe in God the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth. Let me shorten that up a little bit, because I think there are some graduations here that we need to talk about. The first one is this: I believe in a God. Say that. I believe in a God. Many people around us don't believe in God at all. You and I, we open the Bible to the very first page, the very first words, and what do we read? In the beginning, this is where it all starts. This is what Genesis wants us to understand. From absolutely nothing and from out of nothing, God began and created everything that there is. So it's good for us to remember that our very first step in becoming aware of who we were and how we fit into this world must begin with God himself. No matter how confusing the world is, no matter how confusing we make the answers to this problems in our world, God is still in control. Hold on to that thought. He began everything, and nothing has caught him off guard, not even the events of the last couple of years with the pandemic or the wars or the problems or the legislations or the economies or the recession or the inflation. God is not surprised by any of this. I want to graduate to the point where I can understand that God has it all in his control. Now, not everybody understands this. It was kind of interesting. In his book on Albert Einstein, a guy by the name of Walter Isaacson told of a dinner party that was being held in Germany in Einstein's honor. Everybody that was there simply assumed that Albert Einstein, that great scientist, physicist, was an atheist. They assumed that he didn't believe in God, and somebody said something to that effect, to which Einstein is quoted as saying, oh, no, no, no. He said, I have a deep feeling of faith, a deep religiosity that comes from my appreciation of the way the Lord made the universe. Well, everybody in the room was stunned. They couldn't believe that Einstein was confessing his belief in God. So he continued. He said, for me, I feel like I'm a child walking into a library when I look at the heavens. He says, you see the books and you know that somebody must have written the books. And they're all ordered on the shelf and somebody must have put them in order. He said, there's a sense of awe that manifests in me when you kind of understand that there is a creator because creation tells it. You see, we have to begin in the place where we say that the heavens themselves declare the glory of God, which, by the way, is Psalm 19. Psalm 19 already said this. We can't look at nature itself and not say, there is a God. We can look at one another, and I can see God evident in you. There is nothing unique, new, or overwhelming. So I believe in a God, step one. Step two, are you still with me? I believe in the God. I'm not just believing in a God, an entity, a deity of some sort, but I believe that the God that I know and have been taught is the God. A man by the name of Alexander Saul has spent the last 50 years of his life studying the Russian Revolution, which happened about 100 years ago. By the way, there's nothing new under the sun. The fighting that's happening in Russia and Ukraine and so forth is just a rerun of what happened 100 years ago and 225 years ago before that and on and on. So there's nothing new here, but he's studying what happened because it killed over 12 million people in that revolution about 100 years ago. And he came to this conclusion after 5 decades of study. The reason the Russian Revolution happened is because the society forgot God. It's that simple. Any civilization, any society that pushes God out of their education, out of their healthcare, out of their lives in any way is doomed to fail because it was never created to operate without God. The same author ends his book by saying, "As I look at the whole of the 20th century moving into the 21st century, my greatest fear is this. The historians, centuries from now, will look back at our society and conclude the same thing. They continued to forget God." In 1 Kings chapter 8, verses 22 and 23, we read this, that a king named Solomon stood before the altar of the Lord in the presence of all the assembly of Israel, spread out his hands before heaven and said, "O Lord, God of Israel, there is no God like you in heaven above or on earth beneath." Wouldn't it be great if our leaders would stand up and announce that? We are so small and you are so mighty. We are so ignorant and you are so knowledgeable, and we believe that you are not only a God, but the God that can rescue us. See, Solomon was given, in essence, an honorary degree from God himself. You realize this. God gave him some choices, and he chose wisdom over wealth. And God said, "I'll give you both." And on that day, graduated him with an honorary degree in wisdom. But Solomon ended in failure, sadly enough. In 1 Kings chapter 11, just 3 chapters later, we read this. The same man who said, "The presence of God is here, and I stand in this assembly," said, "His heart was not wholly devoted to the Lord his God as the heart of David his father had been." What did he do? Well, he married people who chased after other gods. He couldn't say that his God was the God. He said there are many gods, and he started building altars and worshiping them and contributing to them, and before long, his life collapsed. The same thing is happening to us today in so many ways. I believe what I would call it is consumerism. We have replaced God, a desire for a relationship with God, for a desire with a relationship of things. Everybody's so concerned about the economy, so concerned about the trade deficit, so concerned about can we get what we want when we want it. And I still say that we as believers, so as we as Christians, need to say, if I have God, I don't need anything else. And if I do, my God will provide it. This is what we need to hold on to. So yes, I believe in a God, and I believe that that God I believe in is the God, but I also believe that I can make it personal. He's my God. Now, I don't mean that I can control God. I cannot. I can't understand God, let alone tell him what to do. But David was the one who wrote, "The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer. My God is my rock in whom I take my refuge, my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold and my refuge. My Savior, you save me from violence. I call upon the Lord. He is worthy to be praised, and I am saved from my enemies." What I see happening in the world today is the same thing that has happened in our educational systems. When we took God out of the equation, the facts don't add up. They don't make sense. I've seen too many institutions who started out as Bible colleges based upon the foundation of God's Word, remove that, and now they are simply factories of education that lead people to despair rather than enlightenment. Colossians chapter 1, verses 21 through 23 read like this. "Listen, He says, once you were alienated from God, separated from God. And your enemies, right, were your minds because of your evil behavior. But now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through his death to present you holy in his sight without blemish and free from accusation if you continue in your faith. It's that phrase that we need to hold on to, that as we want to see people growing through their faith, yes, I believe in a God, yes, I believe that that God is the God, that I want to personalize it, meaning I have to continue in my faith. I can't even begin to tell you the statistics of what's happening to our young people who grow up in the church. When they go off to higher education, how many of them never come back. And I don't mean physically, although that happens too. I'm talking about philosophically, theologically. They have been taught that they don't need God anymore, that they are their own gods. This humanism is dragging them away from the truth. We need to teach them again that we need to seek first the kingdom of God, and then life will be added to us. John Adams says there are two types of education. One should teach us how to make a living. That's a good idea. The other education should teach us how to live. Church, this is why we created the Wildwood Academy. We wanted to have a place where we had opportunity to take people who maybe had a degree in anything, everything else, but bring them home and say, but there's so much more to this truth. We wanted to have a place where we could teach them how to love God and to serve him in whatever career field that they find themselves, in whatever doors God was opening, that we would have Christian doctors and lawyers and mechanics and lawn care people and so forth. That we wanted them to have their faith informing their jobs, not the opposite. It was around 1920, about 100 years ago, that a pharmacist bought a drugstore in southern Chicago. He became kind of bored with his job and wanting to serve God with it. He began to dream of ways to make it a more efficient, more exciting occupation. So he kind of started challenging his delivery boys to get there quicker. We need to get the medications that we give to people into their homes faster. So here's what he would do. He was one of the first drugstores that people could call in their prescriptions. And so he would repeat them over the phone. Yes, Mrs. Jones, you need this medication, and this is how many. And as he was repeating it, somebody was filling the order quick, giving it to a delivery boy who would speed off on his bicycle, and he would keep them on the phone. And oftentimes, within about 10 minutes, they were already arriving there, and it was an amazing thing. I called, I'm on the phone, and the drugs are already at my door. Sounds like Amazon, doesn't it? But see, he did this, and it gave him such notoriety that he became incredibly successful in business. But with that success, he was also successful in his faith and sharing it with his church and his community. His name, by the way, anybody know? Charles Walgreen. His faith helped him to build a business which we still recognize today as the pharmacy chain Walgreens. His life has ended, but his faith and his service has served him far beyond his days. He graduated to heaven, but left behind a legacy of faith. This is why we celebrate graduates today. This is why we take these moments to do this. As we begin to move into that phase, let's go ahead and just have a word of prayer for our graduates. Would you bow with me, please? Lord God, we thank you for the decorations and for the cakes, and we thank you for the gatherings and for these young people. We see in them ourselves, maybe years ago, when we were so wide-eyed and excited, and life has worn us down a bit, but also given us wisdom to know that you have something so much greater for us. Lord, help us to teach them to seek first the kingdom of God. Help us to help them to know that you are not only a God amongst many, but the God and the only true one, that they can make you their God to live by daily, to know the truth and let that truth set them free. We thank you for this worship time where we honor you by giving credit to them And we thank you for this church family and body, that we can embrace one another in this way. For we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Would you stand with us?
Living for Jesus,
a life that is true, striving to please Him in all that I do, yielding allegiance, glad-hearted and free. This is the pathway of blessing for me. Oh, Jesus, Lord and Savior, I give myself to Thee, for Thou in Thy atonement didst give Thyself for me. I own no other master, my heart shall be Thy throne. My life I give henceforth to live, O Christ, for Thee alone. Living for Jesus, who died in my place, bearing on Calvary my sin and disgrace. Such love constrains me to answer the call, follow His leading and give Him my all. Oh, Jesus, Lord and Savior, I give myself to Thee, for Thou in Thy atonement didst give Thyself for me. I own no other master, my heart shall be Thy throne. My life I give henceforth to
It is so nice to see you guys once again. My name is Chris. I'm the student minister here at Wildwood. And this morning, we are just taking just a couple of minutes of your time to recognize and honor the graduates that we have within our church, specifically our high school graduates this year. You'll see a list up there of the names of those that we know are graduating or have graduated, actually many of them at this point. But we're going to ask something of you guys. All right, whether you know these young people or not, out in the foyer, there's a table, and at the table, there are five boxes, and there's a name on the front of each one of those boxes, and the names look a lot like those names up there. Here's the thing. I know that you guys have some wise wisdom for them, some wise words that you can give them. Maybe a Bible verse that has meant something to you in your life. And so I just ask you, we have some cards out there, write a quick little message to them. Whether you know them or not, you will be encouraging them. And just drop it in those boxes. All right, if you had any cards or anything like that, you can drop them in there as well. But also what we're going to be doing this morning, and I just wanted to kind of let you guys know, is they will get a little package from us here at Wildwood. And in that package, there's a few items. There is some llama gummies and some llama and a little stuffed llama. The reason for that is not random. In our student ministry, we have adopted the llama as our mascot. If you see our t-shirts or anything like that, everything that we do basically has a llama on it. Why? There's really no reason. Welcome to youth ministry, okay? But we put llamas in there intentionally this year because we want them to remember that no matter where they go, that they're never too far from home. That they can remember and know that they still have a home here, that they still have a place here, that they have a church family that cares about them, that's praying for them, that loves them. The other thing that's in here is a Starbucks card, because whether they're going into the workforce full time, whether they're going to college, caffeine, okay? I don't know, for many of us, that is how we get through and got through. But the last thing that's in here is a hammock. And that hammock to me is the most important thing that's in this package. Because on the tag here, it has a reminder and a verse on here, Matthew 11:28-30. And if you're unfamiliar with that verse, it really is a two verses that is about where we can find true rest in life. So no matter how stressful life gets, no matter what direction that they are taken in this life, we hope that they never forget where they find their rest. And we hope that hammock is a reminder that their rest, yeah, they can get physical rest anywhere with this hammock, but they can get spiritual rest only in one place, and that is God. So please take just a couple of moments to honor them in the foyer. If you see them running around, we've got a very introverted senior class this year. So they're, you know, like I had two of them that were like, you could ask me to come up on stage, just do not make me say anything. And I'm like, all right. And then I had one that's like, I'm not going up there. And I'm like, all right. But they'll be around today. If you see them, if you know them, just give them a congrats. All right. And so we're going to go ahead, and if you guys would, please just pray with me. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so very much for this day. We thank you for all the things that we've had to celebrate here recently. Right here at Wildwood, we've had, you know, more than a dozen baptisms just in the last 3 or 4 weeks. We've had Mother's Day last week. We've had graduation that we're celebrating this week and graduation that we're celebrating next week. And we get to do it all as a family of God, as the body of Christ, as a community that is connected under one name, and that name is Jesus. Lord, we thank you so much that we have the opportunity to celebrate. That is a discipline that you have called us to, a discipline of joy, a discipline of celebration. Lord, I just pray that you be with each one of our graduates as they leave the proverbial nest, that you would help them not forget the values that they learned through their parents, the values that they learned through their family, but also that they would not forget the values that they picked up here at Wildwood. I just ask that you help all of us to go in peace today, and that we find joy in you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. And also next week, real quick, just we'll be celebrating again. There will be a reception for Dr. Ron next week after all the services. So go in peace, and we will see you next week.